Hi, welcome to Hand of the Plow. I'm Betty Newman, and I'm so glad you could join us for this. This lesson is going to be intense. We are going to look at how did Jesus say, "Thy will be done." I think you're going to learn something today. As we continue this journey from supper to sunrise, considering how we are to respond when tough things happen, or as we're calling it, when the ground gives way beneath you, we come in this lesson to the Garden of Gethsemane. Now, I dare say we all know about the Garden of Gethsemane, but I want to challenge us to learn more about what took place in that hour or so, and maybe see how what we learn from that can strengthen us in our own dark hours and when we face difficult times. We saw in our last lesson, which was titled The Real Lord's Prayer, we saw how Jesus paused before crossing over the Kidron Valley. He stopped, he just stopped in his tracks, I think, and began praying. He prayed a prayer that has come to be known as the Great High Priestly Prayer. He was fulfilling his role as the Great High Priest. And in that role, he prayed first of all for himself as well as for the sacrifice, just like the High Priest would do on the Day of Atonement. The High Priest would pray first of all for himself to forgive his sins, and then he would pray for the sacrifice. Jesus did the same thing. He prayed for himself, and then he prayed for the sacrifice, which was himself. He prayed also for the disciples. We saw that the high priest would have the names of the 12 tribes of Israel on a breastplate that he would wear, and they were literally on his heart. You and I were on Jesus' heart as he prayed that day. This great high priest would lift these up and pray for them, and then he prayed for those, Jesus prayed for those who would believe because of what the disciples would say. That's you and me. We talked last time literally about how we are on Jesus' prayer list. When the high priestly prayer ends at the end of John 17, then we read in John chapter 18, verse 1, when Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the ravine of the Kidron, where there was a garden into which he himself entered and his disciples with him. And then the next thing that John gives us in his gospel is Jesus' arrest. According to John's gospel, we don't know what happened in the garden. We have to go to the synoptic gospels, to Matthew, Mark, and Luke, to piece together what happened during that time that he was in the garden. But one thing we notice that John does tell us, he says they were in a garden. The other disciples, the other gospels don't tell us that, but John calls it a garden. I've often wondered why John didn't. I mean, you know, why wouldn't he share this? Why wouldn't he give an account of that time? Obviously, John's gospel was written much later than the other three, and maybe he concluded that the other three had covered it so well that he didn't need to add anything to it. We know that Luke wrote from eyewitness accounts, so maybe Luke talked with John. Maybe Luke got John's input as he wrote his gospel. We know also that Mark's gospel is pretty much a recollection of Peter's, or a compilation of Peter's recollections and Peter's sermons. So if you recall, Peter and John too, for that matter, were mostly asleep when all this was taking place. So how much could they remember? Perhaps Jesus shared with his disciples after the resurrection the things that took place. Or maybe the Holy Spirit revealed this to them. But there could have been another eyewitness. In Mark's gospel, in Mark 14, verses 51 and 52, right after the guards have arrested Jesus, after the disciples have fled, we read this. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They, that was the soldiers, caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. Now, this is only found in John or in Mark's gospel, and most scholars think that this young man was Mark himself. Some speculate that Mark was a young boy, a young man, that he sneaked out of the house and he followed Jesus and the disciples. I mean, they were his heroes. And he sneaked out of the house and followed them to see where they were going and what was going to happen next. And that's how he came to be at the garden. Others think that perhaps Judas and the soldiers actually went to John Mark's parents' house first looking for Jesus, because after all, that's where they were when Judas left, and he thought maybe they were still there. But they weren't there, and Judas would have known where they were going next. So Mark, being a young boy, left the house, took a shortcut, and got to the garden to warn them. But when he got there, Jesus was praying and struggling in prayer, and Mark didn't interrupt him. I imagine if that was the scenario, Mark was just mesmerized by the struggle, the intense struggle that Jesus was going through. Whichever it was, you and I can thank the Holy Spirit that we have this account of Jesus' last and his most intense prayer in the garden when he was alone with his Father. Many times as we go through our Holy Week services, we seem to hopscotch from the Last Supper to the cross to the empty tomb, and we don't spend a lot of time either on this prayer or on the trials that Jesus will go through, which we will cover in another lesson. In this prayer, it is here that Jesus reaches the very depth of his humanity. Now, the word Gethsemane actually means oil press. So the Garden of Gethsemane could actually be called the Garden with the Gethsemane, or the Garden with the oil press. Most likely, this garden belonged to a wealthy friend of Jesus, and this friend allowed Jesus and his disciples to stay there when the weather was nice. They would sleep outside under the stars. In fact, Luke 22:39 tells us after they left the upper room, he came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. So now, Jesus and his disciples have arrived there. They've entered the garden. So let us listen in. I'm going to be reading a compilation from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 26, verses 36 through 45, along with details added in from Mark and from Luke. Now, I normally study in the New American Standard, but there's just something about the intensity that comes through in the translation of the King James Version. So listen to these words. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith to the disciples, sit here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and James and John, the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further, about a stone's throw, and he fell on his face, and he prayed that if it were possible that this hour might pass from him. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible with you. Take away this cup from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what thou wilt. And he cometh back unto the disciples, and finding them asleep, he saith unto Peter, what? Could you not tarry 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And he went away the second time, and he prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. And then Luke tells us in Luke 22, 43 and 44, Luke says, and there appeared an angel unto him, from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, Jesus prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling on the ground. The angel came and didn't take the agony away. Strengthened him, but he didn't take the agony away. Back to Matthew 26, verse 43. And Jesus came and found them, the disciples, asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, and they didn't know how to answer him. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. And then cometh he to his disciples, and he said unto them, sleep on now, and take your rest. I can imagine him taking a deep breath. Behold, the hour is at hand. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. I don't know about you, but we just can't read this and remain unmoved. This agony that Jesus felt. Though he was fully God, he was fully man. Even as I say this, I feel chills. What he felt when he went through that. His fear was so very real in his humanity. We cannot begin to imagine the terror that he felt on that night. But he knew fully what lay ahead of him. As we look at this prayer, I pray that we'll stop and think for a few moments. Think about what our salvation, what our redemption from an eternity in hell really cost. Well, first of all, we see that Jesus was grieved to the point of death. Matthew 26:38 says, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. That phrase, exceeding sorrowful, is the Greek word palupos. It's from the words peri and upe, which mean to grieve all around. We get our word periscope. It was something that goes all the way. It was all encompassing of him. He was surrounded by, he was totally engulfed by grief. It was almost beyond endurance. And Jesus prayed three times that the cup might be taken away. And each time he prayed, he came back to sleeping disciples. So we may ask, why did he take Peter and James and John? Why didn't he just take all the disciples? Well, first of all, these three were the leaders. Peter would be the one who would take the gospel to the Gentiles. James would be the first of the disciples to be martyred. And John would be the last to die. These three would be singled out, not necessarily because they were the leaders, but because they needed to be taught more. One writer said that Jesus took these three for their benefit, not necessarily for his. Many writers talk about Jesus needing comfort that night. He didn't want to be alone. He wanted those three to be with him. And he does say to them, watch with me, but the more I've studied it, the more it seems in keeping with this is what Jesus would do, is it not? He would take them for their own benefit. No matter what he's about to go through, he's still thinking of their benefit and of our benefit. And he said to them, watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. We can't expect to enter a crisis and automatically know Scripture, to know where to turn. It's just all there. We know exactly what to do for comfort unless we have prepared ahead of time, unless we have drilled these things into our hearts in advance. In Ephesians 6, we read about the armor of God, and it says that our only offensive weapon is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And I've often said that if we don't know the Word of God, then we have a dull and rusty sword. We have to prepare. We cannot expect to know how to pray in a moment of need if we haven't cultivated a relationship with our Father beforehand. Intercessory prayer is a wonderful thing. I love knowing when people are praying for me. And I think people appreciate knowing when I'm praying for them. Intercessory prayer is great, but it will not take the place of time spent in prayer on our own knees, pouring out our own hearts before our Father. William Barclay said, "If we can call God Father, then everything else becomes bearable." Jesus may have just wanted these disciples there with him, but I really think it was for their benefit and ultimately for ours. But what did Peter and James and John do? They promptly fell asleep. J. Vernon McGee says that although you and I sang, "I'll stay in the garden with him," no, we won't. We can't go in that garden with him. That's one place we can't go. And aren't we glad? Aren't we glad that he left us outside that agony? We are out with his disciples. We, thanks to the writers of the Gospels, we can peer over the wall, maybe as John Mark was doing. We can watch, but we can never feel that anguish that Jesus felt. Thank God. And then we see Jesus praying virtually the same thing three times. Why does he do that? Now there are several differences of opinion of just what this cup is that Jesus prays for God to pass by. Some believe it was a premature death there in the garden. He does say, "My soul is grieved to the point of death." Others think that it was the cup of God's wrath, which is a well-documented theme throughout the Bible. Or possibly, as John Wesley taught, it was the cup of terror and fear. And others said it may have been an avoidance of the cross altogether. As you remember, right after Jesus was baptized by John, he went into the wilderness where he fasted 40 days and was tempted by Satan. Those temptations were to turn the stone into bread, to fall down and worship Satan, or to leap from the pinnacle of the temple. And many have referred to these as the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. But whatever we call them, they were ultimately cumulative. Altogether, they were a temptation that would culminate in an avoidance of the cross. It was taking a shortcut. If Jesus had given in to any one of those temptations, the cross, and with it our salvation, would have never taken place. Now, perhaps we'll study the cup in depth at another time. Whatever the cup actually was, is not the subject of this study. It's what Jesus did with the cup that is our concern this time. E.M. Bounds, in his book titled The Reality of Prayer, says that the Gethsemane prayer that Jesus prayed, Jesus sought to be relieved from that which seemed too heavy to bear. He prayed, however, not in revolt against God, but in submission to his will. And yet Jesus prayed that the cup pass. How can that be? So think about this for a moment. Bounds said that Jesus prayed to change God's plan and to alter the purpose. How would that be? Does it bother you that Jesus may have prayed to change the plan? Do you think you've ever prayed against the purposes of God? Of course we have. Ian Bounds goes on to say, simple submission to God's will is not the highest attitude of the soul to God. Now bear with me here. I'm going somewhere with this. Bounds says, in essence, there is a difference between submitting to God's will and conforming to God's will. Conformity to God's will involves submission, but submission in and of itself falls short and does not necessarily include conforming. Think about this. Got a couple of cake pans here. If I take these two cake pans, and into one of them I pour water, and in the other one I pour cake batter. Both will have submitted, both the water and the cake batter will have submitted to the shape of the pan. But if I take these pans and I put them in the oven for 30 minutes or so at 350 degrees or so, only the batter will conform to the shape of the pan. The water, though submitted to the shape, when the heat is over, will pour right out. A prisoner of war may submit to his captors, but seldom will he conform to their ideology. Conformity means to stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. It means to delight to do God's will. William Barclay goes on to teach in his commentary that it makes all the difference in the world in what tone of voice someone says, "Thy will be done." He may say it in a tone of helpless submission, as one who is in the grip of a power against which it's hopeless to fight. These words are, he says, are the death knell of hope. This is when we pray with teeth clenched and fists by our side, "Thy will be done." We don't really mean it, but we know we don't have a choice. Another way to say it is when someone has been battered into submission. These words may be the admission of complete defeat. That still yet is not the way to say or to pray, "Thy will be done." Another may say it as one who has been utterly frustrated, who sees that the dream can never come true, that the words are just regret over what will never be, can never be. It's also a bitter anger made even the more bitter because he can't do anything about it. Or a person may say it with the accent of perfect trust. That's how Jesus said it. Jesus was speaking to the one that he called Father. Jesus was speaking to the one that you and I call Father. Jesus was speaking to a God whose everlasting arms were underneath him and are all around him, even as he hung on the cross. Jesus was submitting, yes, but he was submitting to a love that would never let him go. Life's hardest task is to accept what we cannot understand. But we can do that. We can accept what we do not understand if we are sure of God's love. Are you sure of God's love? Have you given yourself completely to Him, allowing Him, even in the heat of difficult times, to conform you to His will? That's a hard thing to do. Jesus, in His humanity, prayed that this cup may pass by. But the cup could not pass by. The cup, He knew, as God, had to be consumed. But His humanity, His humanity did not want to go through that. And so He prayed, "Thy will be done." Let me illustrate this by sharing the story of a friend of mine. She found a lump under her arm one morning as she was putting on her deodorant. It was about 7 a.m., and, you know, at that time, it's about an hour or so before she could call the doctor's office and make an appointment. And so what she did in that hour was to pray. She spent that hour in agony, actually. She had two small children. She loved her husband deeply. And she was naturally worried. The word lump strikes a fear in anyone's heart, and it did hers. She was a Christian, And she knew what the outcome of even the worst diagnosis would be, and that would be an eternity with Christ. But no one wants to go through pain and suffering, and so she prayed. The first prayer, at first, her prayer was to beg God that it not be anything serious. But, resignedly, ending as she had always been taught, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." Then her prayer progressed to a, "But if it is serious, if we can't avoid this suffering," she took a deep breath, "whatever you say, Lord, your will be done." She continued to pray and cry, thinking of her children and her husband and her family and all those that she loved. And she, as she prayed, though, a calmness came over her, a peace that she didn't understand. She saw that her loving God and Father loved her children and her husband more than she did, more than she ever could. And that even if the diagnosis was a serious one, God was still God. God was still on the throne, and God would provide no matter what. So as she rose from her knees, she reached for the telephone and she confidently then declared, "Thy holy and perfect will be done." That's what Jesus spoke. He spoke like that, and when we speak like that, we can look up and in perfect trust say, "Thy will be done." And we can be conformed to the image of God, regardless of what life brings, regardless of the heat, regardless of the situation. We must be conformed to the will of God. And if we were just studying the prayer, we could stop our lesson there. But we're studying these events that take place from supper to sunrise, that faithful night. We're learning what to do when the ground starts shaking beneath us. And the next thing that happens on this night is that when Jesus comes back to the disciples, the third time, he can see coming up through the Kidron Valley the crowd of soldiers. And the diagnosis, if we want to call it that, is the worst that it can be. In our next lesson, we'll look at the 6 illegal trials that Jesus underwent. May God bless you today.